right, good morning. Welcome to Cross Community Church again. I'm really glad to be here, really thankful to have the opportunity to specifically preach through the book of Philippians. I'm going to tell the story here in a little bit, but we took a class on the book of Philippians, and it's been a hugely impactful book in my life because of the professor we had, I think because of the depth that we got to walk through Philippians, and I'm just so excited that as a church we get to bring a little bit of that depth and truth to us on a Sunday morning. And I'm also really thankful to serve at a church who values Scripture and what it has to say and is willing to, through a long period of time, walk through Scripture and understand what's going on in our world, and not just to preach sermons that sound pretty or to always be culturally relevant. And there's nothing absolutely wrong with engaging our culture and being relevant, but there's absolutely something wrong when we never give the word to our people. And so really glad to be here this morning. Again, my name is Brandon, and even though I've served at the church for nearly 9 years now, I know that there are still people that don't know me. Much of the time I was at Pecola and served in worship and in youth ministry over there. But I didn't grow up in Oklahoma, but I claim Oklahoma as my home. And I moved to Red Oak right after college. So, like, fresh with a bachelor's degree in a big town, moved to a town of 500, and just completely, like, wrecked my life. It was culture shock, and it was like stepping into, like, a completely different country almost, but I loved it. And I lived in Red Oak for, like, 3 years, but I had only been there, like, a couple of months, and we went on vacation with some friends. And, you know, the waiter or the waitress always asks you, like, where are you guys from? And I'm like, Oklahoma. And my brother's like, no, you're not. You grew up in Arkansas. I'm like, oh, I claim it now. I'm an Okie now, and I still am to this day. I do love Oklahoma, but I did grow up in Van Buren, Arkansas, so not too far away, but different enough that some of the same, like, shared experiences and even culture is just a little bit different there. But I grew up in Van Buren. I had very thankful to have a mom and a dad who loved my brother-in-law and I truly, who did their best to be a good example of what it was like to follow Christ, who made sure that we were in church every Sunday and every Wednesday, even though that caused some angst in me and some anger when I didn't understand, why can't I just spend some time with my friends? You know, we were at church. It was important. Now, they weren't perfect, and as a parent, I know I'm not perfect, but I'm so thankful for the godly influence they were in my life. But I grew up in Van Buren. Grew up in church every Wednesday, every Sunday, every special event that was going on, like, we were there. That was my life growing up. And I remember from a very early age, I got saved. It was a true and authentic experience that I had where I gave my life to Christ. And I felt in that moment a weight of sin lifted off my shoulders. And I was like 7 or 8 years old. And like, how like dirty and sinful are you at 7 or 8? Not much, but enough to spend an eternity in hell without the life-changing work of Christ in me. And so I gave my life to Christ. But life wasn't perfect. And I always felt like in school and just life in general, I didn't know, like, what is God, like, where do I fit in? Yes, I was a believer. Yes, I knew some things about the Bible. I went to Sunday school and I knew some stuff, but also as much as I had an authentic faith in Christ, I also had the flesh still very alive and well within me. I had a lot of times where I was feeding that flesh, where I was doing the things that I wanted to do, and I yearned for friendship. I yearned for belonging. I yearned for acceptance, like many young kids do. In junior high, which is absolutely the most awkward time in your whole life, I remember just not fitting in, not feeling like I belonged anywhere, struggling, and just being awkward, you know, and you're just a kid. And I remember being a part of a youth group, though, at the same time, where there were guys and girls in that youth ministry that I really looked up to, that I thought did a good job of setting an example and showing what an authentic walk with Christ looked like. They were guys that led us in worship. They were guys and girls that prayed when they were called upon, right? And they were, they even led Bible studies sometimes. I remember going to some Bible studies at Hardee's and just reading through and just being so affected. And for me, it was you search and you yearn for belonging, right? And so especially as a Christian, at that age when life is as awkward as it can be, we are struggling because you have desires, you have sinful desires that are in you that you don't know what to do with a lot and that you want to feed and that you do feed sometimes, right? I remember finding some of that belonging in that group. And it was honestly at that point an encouraging time until that was completely shattered for me. So when I moved from 9th grade into 10th grade, and that's just how it worked in Van Buren, it was a different building. From 9th grade to 10th grade was now the high school building. I remember walking into high school, and I was kind of excited to be done with the horribleness of junior high and to go on to high school. And I remember walking in and seeing some of these very guys and girls that I thought were living out authentic faith, that lived just like everybody else, that did the same things, that said the same things, that looked no different than the world, that walked in their flesh day by day. Not just like one, but like most of them. And I remember how shattering and how destructive that was in my life. And now, not to be unfair, because the decisions that I made were the decisions that I made, and I bore the responsibility for those. But it's interesting how powerful an example can be in our life, whether good or whether bad. And it's interesting how it can lead us down paths that cause us to even question our faith. Like, if these guys and girls who I thought were true believers were really living like everybody else, then was Jesus even real? Is faith authentic? Can we really live this out in this earth if I don't even have people around me that are living that out? And I think it's interesting because sometimes we don't understand the destructiveness of our actions out in the world whenever we choose to live a life that's just like everybody else, and when we choose to come to church and put on a mask. I just remember how destructive that was. And so this morning, Paul's going to get into that. He's going to get into the power of example. He's going to get into maturity and how we have to pursue that together. And so he's going to speak very clearly and very plainly about that. So if you would open up your Bibles to Philippians chapter 3, verse 12. And now, I would be remiss if I didn't remind us this morning that this message that I'm preaching today is built specifically off of what Jason had to say last week. Paul is fleshing out what it looks like to grow and what it looks like to have the process of salvation working out in your life. So he was making a distinction. For many of us, when we think of the time we were saved, when we think of what salvation is, we hearken back to that time where we placed our faith in Christ for that first time. We think about that prayer that you prayed, wherever that was. For me, it was at my grandpa's house at the age of like 7 or 8. And for some of us, it was church camp. For some of us, it was more recent. But we think that's salvation. And Paul was warning believers about the danger of thinking that now I'm saved, the salvation has already worked in my life, and now we just live life willy-nilly until we die and we go on to be with Jesus in heaven. But Paul said that is not salvation in our life. That is not how it works in our life. Paul said there's three parts to salvation. First, he said in the process of salvation, there's the justification. So he kind of fleshed it out in verse 10, but he basically said, that I want to know Christ, yes, to know the power of his resurrection. So he wanted to know the power of his resurrection. That's another way to think of it, is the justification. Even though he didn't use these terms, these are the things and the ideas that he was conveying to the Philippian church. He said, first we have justification. So that's the time when we place our faith in Christ. It's the process of the penalty and the judgment and the weight of sin being lifted off of our shoulders because it's been paid for by the blood of Christ. And when we place our faith in Christ, we're now justified. All of our sin, past, present, future, that we could ever commit has been paid for. And now we are justified. For many believers, that's where we end. We've been justified. And we kind of get stuck there. But he says it goes on. Salvation is more than just the justification. Salvation is next, sanctification. So he goes, into let's see, verse 10. Oh yeah, and participation in his sufferings. That's how Paul fleshed out sanctification. Sanctification is the process by which we become like Christ. From justification, we day by day live out sanctification. It's the power of the Holy Spirit working in us to change who we are. It's not us changing ourselves. It's not just about knowledge. It's about knowledge and practice together. We grow in our faith with Christ, and we are all, if you have placed your faith in Christ, if you have been justified, now we are working together to be sanctified. We are allowing Christ to work in us day by day. And finally, it's the glorification. It's the completion of the process of salvation. And he says it like this, becoming like him in his death. And I remember the first time I read that, I was like, that's really hard, because like Jesus was crucified. And absolutely, like in Paul's mind, there were definitely connotations and just thoughts of being willing to pay the ultimate price for his faith, even unto death. Now, according to church history and the tradition that we have, we actually don't know what happened to Paul, whether he was crucified, whether he lived on to be an old man and just to die. But what Paul is getting here is it's more than just about the way that you died. For Paul, it was the process of glorification that happens in this life. He's going to say this here in just a minute, but it's the shedding and the transformation of our lowly earthly bodies by which Jesus, by his power, makes us like him. We are literally made new. Our mind is transformed. Everything about us is transformed, and we no longer have to walk with this dirty, ragged flesh that we are walking with right now, fighting with day by day. We are made perfect, and we get to walk with Christ. And throughout this whole process, the prize is Christ. The prize isn't perfection at some point. The prize was Christ. And the glorification is the ability to now walk in complete unity and relationship with Christ. And so Paul's fleshing these ideas out, and then he begins on in verse 12 and kind of continues to talk about specifically first the process of sanctification. So here's what he says in Philippians chapter 3, verse 12. He says, "Not that I have already obtained all this or already arrived at my goal." So he's like, I'm not glorified yet. I'm not perfect yet. But he says, "But I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me." That's salvation. That's the process. That's a relationship with Christ. And then he says in verse 13, "Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus." So Paul is saying, listen, like, I forget what was my past. Now, you remember last week, Paul talked about he was a sinner. He was a great Jewish person who thought he was following God, but was actually persecuting Jesus and persecuting the church. Paul considers himself to be the worst of sinners. And yet Paul can stand up and say, I forget what lies behind because I've been justified, because my sin has been paid for, because Christ has transformed me. And now we walk day by day. We press on day by day. We run a race. You see that idea of a race through Scripture all the time. We run a race together day by day, and we run as if to win the prize. The prize, again, Christ Jesus. The prize, the completion of the salvation process in our life. So Paul's encouraging people to live out their faith, to walk in sanctification day by day, to allow the power of the Holy Spirit to transform our minds and our lives, to allow us to not gratify the sinful desires of our flesh, as Galatians chapter 5 would teach us. And then he goes on. So it's not just about sanctification. He goes on to the power of something else. Verse 15, "All of us then who are mature should take a view of such things." Again, mature people should understand that salvation is a process in our life. "And if on some point you think differently, that too God will make clear to you." Basically, if you don't think it's like this, you're wrong, and you know what? God's going to change your heart. He says, "Only let us live up to what we have already attained." tells the Philippian church, join together in following my example, brothers and sisters, and just as you have us as a model. Keep your eyes on those who live as we do. For as I have often told you before, and now tell you again, even with tears, many live as enemies of the cross of Christ. So he says, Philippian church, follow my example. Follow our example. Now, he's not saying this in a conceited way. He's not saying, like, listen, I'm Paul. I'm perfect. I was a sinner, but now I'm good. And now I want you to be transformed into my image. I want you to be transformed into Paul's image. No, he's saying, follow me as I follow Christ. We all, the goal is Christ. The purpose is to what he says earlier, that to live is Christ, but to die is gain. And it's not just about us. He says, join with us. Paul's talking about who? Himself. He's talking about Timothy, perhaps Epaphroditus, who we had a message on just a few weeks ago, or other church leaders. But he's saying, listen, we press on to maturity together. We're not perfect. We're broken people. But we press on to faith together because we need each other. And just real quickly, I didn't do this first service, but real quickly, look at the relationship that Paul had with the Philippian church. Just look at how he had, so that we know that this is not his conceitedness at work in him, but the power of a relationship with him. And this is not Paul as an elder and as a leader of the church, just writing as this great leader to this lowly church. These are people that Paul loved and had a relationship with. And you don't have to turn here, but we're just going to kind of briefly hit some of these. In chapter 1, verse 3, he says, I thank God every time I remember you, because Paul was with them when the church began. Paul was the man who went, met with Lydia, met with a jailer, met with a demon-possessed woman. This really interesting start of the church. He was there at the beginning, and he had an authentic love for them, and he thanked God every time. In chapter 1, verse 7, it is right for me to feel this way about all of you, since I have you in my heart. Again, that relationship. In verse 1:21, for me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. He says, convinced of this, I know that I will remain and I will continue with all of you for your progress and joy in the faith. He was like, listen, for me to live is Christ, but for me to die is gain. It's better for me. And I would love to choose to go on to be with Christ in heaven. But he said, it's better for you, for this church, that I remain on. And if I remain on, it'll be fruitful labor for me because of his love and his authentic relationship he had with him. In verse 2:2, make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being in one spirit and of one mind. Verse 2:12, therefore, my dear friends, they were his friends. They weren't the congregation that was far off. They were his friends and his people. In 2:19, I hope in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you soon, that I also may be cheered when I receive news about you. Finally, in verse 3:1, rejoice in the Lord. It is no trouble for me to write the same things to you again, and it is a safeguard for you. The love, even as a father to these people. The point this morning was that Paul was communicating to the people that as we walk through the process of salvation in our lives, that we need each other, that we need men and women to encourage us, because the days are dark, because our flesh wages battle with us every day. And if we don't stay on top of that, if we aren't day by day seeking Christ and allowing the Holy Spirit to work in our lives, we end up broken. He's saying this because he's saying, listen, in your faith, it's not enough to go it alone in this world. Not that Christ is insufficient, but that God has wired each and every one of us to live in community with other believers. I mean, just look at the book of Genesis. God said about Adam, let us make man in our image. And then he made a helper suitable for him in Eve. God himself placing his image on mankind because we needed relationship. God lives in community with himself in the form of the Trinity, one being yet distinct. Still can't wrap my mind around that completely, but God lives within community in himself. If he made us in his image, he made us to live in community with him and in community with others. That's just that. You could have a whole message on that, but just as an example. Paul loved the church. And he said, listen, we have to walk together. We work together. We press press on to maturity together. And his warning was this. In verse 18 again, he says, "For as I have often told you and before, and now tell you again, even with tears, many live as enemies of the cross of Christ. Their destiny is destruction. Their God is their stomach, and their glory is in their shame. And their mind is set on earthly things." You see, as believers, our minds should be set on Christ, on heavenly things. But one of the dangers of going alone in this world is ending up as enemies of the cross of Christ. Now, theologically, as we look at this, it's a little hard to understand completely, like, what specific group of people Paul was talking about, whether that was Jewish people who had faith in God but had somehow missed out on the Messiah that they had longed for so long, whether that was people that he had met with in Philippi that were not Jewish people, but perhaps were people like in the parable of the sower with Jesus who had received the kingdom and the seed had been planted and tried to grow but had either grown on hard soil, had been placed amongst the weeds where it had been choked out. But people, nonetheless, that Paul was heartbroken for. Let me tell you that as a pastor, as someone who has served in youth ministry and poured my life into people, there is nothing harder to walk through, and the emotions that you have to walk through as people that you've poured your life into walk away from Christ. It's absolutely heartbreaking. To me, it sounds like Paul is speaking about these people, and his heart's broken because they miss out on the best thing in this life. And he says in verse 20, "But our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ, who by the power that enables him to bring everything under his control will transform our lowly bodies so that they will be like his glorious body." Again, this is that last process, the completion of salvation, the glorification. Like, we have a heavenly mind. We look forward to the day that we get to be with Christ, where again, our lowly earthly body is shed and transformed into something completely different, and we live with him in perfection and in perfection of a relationship with him forever. He says, as Christians, that's the goal for us. That's what we press on toward every day, and we need to do that together. Fortunately for me, my story didn't end in 10th grade, and God changed my life. So pretty much my whole sophomore year of high school, I did what I wanted. I filled my flesh. I fell in with the other guys and girls, and I wanted acceptance. I wanted community, but it was the wrong type. Again, I'm responsible for the decisions I made. And I remember at the end of my sophomore year, I was exhausted from the sin. Jesus had already saved me. The Holy Spirit was not going to let me live in that way any longer. I felt conviction. I still remember vividly just having enough. I sat with my parents, who were here this morning in the service. I sat with my parents on the counter. I've shared this story here before, but I sat with them in the counter of our kitchen and poured out and confessed all of my sin to them. They met me with grace and love. They didn't have to, and they maybe shouldn't have, but they did. We went and we prayed with our temporary youth pastor at the time, and the interim youth pastor at the time, he read something with me, and I remembered, like, I knew God was real. I knew Jesus was real. I'd experienced him and wasn't ready to just walk away from the faith, yet who around me, my peers, my friends, was walking with Christ? And I remember being so lonely, trying to live out authentic faith and being so lonely, and I just prayed. I said, God, would you send me friends? God, would you send me people that live out true and authentic faith? And getting choked up again. I thought I'd be fine after first service. It's not true. relationship and that community. And so I did. I just prayed. In our youth group walks in this kid named CJ. He was wild. He was crazy. He had like wild curly hair, but he lived out authentic faith with me. He served as a bridge between my brother and I, who was 3 years younger than me. CJ was like age-wise, like right in between us. From then, my brother and I became super close. We walked out authentic faith together. Like, yeah, we weren't perfect. From there, our youth group kind of built. We had other friends, other guys and girls that came along that were true and that were honest and lived out their faith together. And then we had a we had an interim youth pastor, but we one day had a new youth pastor coming to preach to us in view of a call, and I think it was on a Wednesday. I don't remember completely, but he walked in a suit and a tie, and I think he did. And we're thinking that's pretty uncool. It's pretty weird, but whatever. And and he walked in, and his breath was like super minty. I think he brushed his teeth like 27 times. And he preached, and we loved him. I prayed God would send people in my life. Our youth pastor came, and he poured out his life into us. He lived out true and authentic faith in front of us. He invited us to walk with him as he pursued Christ. He wasn't just a Wednesday night youth pastor that preached his message and went home. We would go over to his house Wednesday night after Wednesday night and eat chili dogs and eat burnt brownies and Little Debbie's and get sick. But we loved it. It was fun. We lived life with him, and it completely changed each and every one of us. His name was Jason Waymire. And I'm so thankful for the impact that he had in my life. He was my youth pastor for a few years and showed us what authentic faith was like, grew something together in a youth ministry. And sometimes I look at my life and I'm like, God, what have you done? Because who am I? I'm nobody. I was a random kid in Van Buren that you plucked out of obscurity. Like, I literally feel like that sometimes. You was plucked out of obscurity. And it's neat to see how God has channeled my life and has controlled the paths of my life all the way to live in Poto, to serve at a church with Jason, and to not only see how that's worked out in my life, but to serve at a church with other men and women who are on staff. There are not only talented individuals, but are people that first and foremost and most importantly live out authentic faith together. To serve at a church with elders who are the same way, who are not just men that lord their authority over us, but men who are an example for us day by day to live an authentic faith. For deacons that are the same way, for women that lead in this church that are the same way. I'm so thankful to be at Cross Community Church. And I don't say this because we're perfect. I don't brag on our staff and on our elders and on our deacons and all the leaders that we have at this church, because we're better than anyone else. In fact, we've heard our deepest, darkest secrets. You've shared with us in our struggle, and we've spoken openly and honestly before you about that. But I simply speak to that today to ask you to walk with us toward Christ, to confess whenever we sin, to know that you're met with love and grace, to continue to pour out, to pursue Christ day by day. Church, I ask, walk with us staff, walk with the leaders that we have here, and let's be a true and authentic community of faith right here in Poto, right here at Cross Community. And I have just two words of application for you this morning. First, I ask that we devote daily. It's part of our six practices of disciple. We didn't just make up some tidy things to make us have a good, process that looks good on paper. And no, we truly believe that the most important thing that you can have in this life is a relationship with Christ. And no, friend, that did not just start at the point of justification, at the point that you placed your faith in Christ, but that we grow day by by day, and we're meant to live differently in this world. We're meant to live as men and women who believe that our hope is in heaven and that Jesus is our treasure. Second is to commit to community. We have to have relationships. We have to do this together. For us to choose to walk in our faith by ourselves is to set ourselves up for failure and to eventually set ourselves up as potentially being enemies of the cross of Christ. We need each other. We need people who can speak truth into our lives. When we're doing something stupid, we need people that will tell us we're doing something stupid. We need people that will encourage us, people that remind us that faith is real, that the world is dark and it's hard to live in, and day by day we struggle with our flesh, but together we can overcome, together we can walk with Christ, together we can pursue maturity, and together we can make a change in this community. And I end by just imploring us, as a church, may we not be just another American church that puts on a show and that is that's happy with just having a sermon, having some worship on a Sunday morning, that's happy with just having people that are walking through our processes. Gosh, may we be a church that searches for Jesus together, that serves him day by day, that day by day we deny ourselves, that day by day we seek after the treasure that is Christ, that day by day we live in complete obedience in every way to Christ, that day by day we see that God has placed us in this church at this time, on this day, in order to reach our community, to be the light in our community that people need. It's dark. There's confusion out there, but there is truth and there is hope found in Jesus. And may we be a church full of people that understand that this life is temporary and that it's important, that God has placed us in our jobs, that God has placed us in our roles in order to be the light, in order to be people that Jesus has called us to be, and in order to point people not to the greatness of Cross Community Church, but to the greatness of Jesus. Would you guys pray with me? God, I thank you so much for Cross Community. I thank you so much for the people that are here. God, it's neat to see how you have woven things together, how you have led people here. God, I'm thankful for this church. I'm thankful for the influence it's had on me. But God, I pray that we just don't settle for having good church. God, I pray that we encourage people to walk in relationship with you. Jesus, I pray over every believer that's in here this morning that our treasure is in Christ. God, I pray over anyone that's in here that doesn't know Christ. I pray this morning that justification process would happen, that they would place their faith in you. Holy Spirit, may you draw us. God, I pray that you use Cross Community Church as a light for the gospel in this community, that we live life in such a different way that people see that there's something different, that they see that there's truth, and even though it's weird, even though it doesn't make sense, even though we seem so out of place in this world, God, I pray that people live authentic faith because they see people at Cross Community living out authentic faith. Jesus, I pray day by day that you would continue by the power of the Holy Spirit to work in us, to work among us. God, would you draw us together as a true community of faith and believers? I pray these things in your holy name.